Nutshell, and we do it all the time, and you guys are good at it. That is something we all know. Then, in order to find the antiderivative, you do the opposite of that.
Divide and add.
You divide and add. However, we have to do it in the complete reverse order. So the first step of an antiderivative is to add 1 to the exponent. And then you're going to divide the coefficient by the new power. That's it. So the antiderivative of a function is notated by that notation. I think it looks like a big S. It also actually, to me, looks like a musical symbol. Looks like something you would see in a music score. But it's an integration sign. That's called an integral. So it's the integration sign f of x dx. This dx is connected to this sign. It's always there. So really, the sign itself is this. And you put the function right here. Okay, so the integral and the dx piece go together. I am notorious for leaving it off, but you're not supposed to. Yeah. It has to be there, and it makes sense when we get into it why it has to be there. I just get ahead of myself and I leave it all the time. Okay, so when we find the antiderivative of a function, you are finding the function of which f of x is the first derivative. So it is taking you backwards, okay? This is going to enable you, if you are given the derivative or the second derivative, it's going to enable you to get all the way back to the original function.
This is what we're talking about.
So, and that's what Hannah said the other day. I wish there was an undo the derivative button on your calculator. Well, guess what? There is. So it's called the antiderivative. So if they gave us acceleration, we could get all the way back to the position vector because we now have the antiderivative and we can go backwards. Okay, the only problem with that is, I want you to just, for just a second, think about this. If I had, let's say, 2x squared plus 3x plus 6, and I take the derivative of that, that would be 4x plus 3 and no plus 6, right? Now, if I'm given this and I want to back up, they said that I can add 1 and then divide, so that would be, that would make this 2, right? And divide by 2, and that would give me 2x squared. Add 1, so I'd put an x and divide by 1, and that gives me 3x. But that's all I was given, and there is no way for me to get the plus 6. That's the only problem with these, is that you cannot get the constant from them. So when it says, what problem do you foresee? Constant. It's the y-intercept. So I can still at least get the shape of of something, I can get, we call this an indefinite integral, because I can get the shape, I can get the stretch, I can get all of that. The only thing I don't have is the vertical shift. So they're called indefinite integrals because of that. Okay, so we're gonna just find an antiderivative, exactly how they said. We're gonna add to the exponent and divide. So this first one, I'm gonna write out the steps. So this would be 3x to the third divided by 3 plus 2x squared divided by 2 plus 3x divided by 1. And then I'm going to put plus c to indicate that I know that there's probably a constant there. Now we'll simplify it. That gives me x cubed plus x squared plus 3x. Plus c. That's your indefinite integral. You have to put the plus c. Okay. Okay, before I take the antiderivative of this, I'm going to rewrite it, because rewriting is my friend. So this will be x squared plus 2 minus 4x to the negative 1. So the antiderivative of x squared plus 2 minus 4x is a negative 1 dx. Are y'all good? I just rewrote this inside piece.
Okay.
X goes to each thing, so.
And where'd you get the x squared?
So it was x cubed, but with an x underneath it, that becomes x squared.
But I thought you were bringing the x up.
I'm not bringing it up. I was doing this. I did this. X cubed over x plus 2x over x minus 4 over x. I did that, and in my head, that's squared, those canceled, and that moves up. I just did it all in one step. Sorry, I probably should have written it out. Okay, now, we'll take the antiderivative.
Yeah, can we do this in our calculator? Does this work in your calculator? Like, can you plug stuff in like that and do it?
Heck yes.
So I get x cubed over 3 plus 2x over 1. Anybody remember?
It's gonna be just nothing, right? It's gonna be no x at all because you're just gonna have one that's gonna go to 0, which is 1.
Yes.
Nothing.
And when that happens, I don't know if y'all remember doing this with integration, but it's actually natural log of x.
What?
I mean, with differentiation.
What?
Yeah, 0.
Yeah.
And, well, it really, I want you to think about it for just a second.
Wait, what? But I thought your constant goes away because you divide.
What's the derivative of that?
But
so
wait.
We're going backwards.
So if that's what you got, because that's what you would have gotten, so
you're going backwards.
Yeah.
Because this is 1 over x.
Oh, yeah, yeah, okay.
And the derivative of 1 over x, or the derivative of log x is 1 over x, so if you want to take the antiderivative of 1 over x, you're back to log x.
Okay.
Yes?
Makes more, I guess.
I know I didn't take y'all's phones, don't worry, that won't work yet.
Jerks. Nobody's been on their phone. What are you talking about?
I just saw your screen of your phone casting
the
light.
No,
that's the light
on
that.
Oh, okay.
Here's a light.
All right.
Here's a light on the pin.
You're forgiven. Okay, so I'm going to correct.
Got him.
Now,
got him.
Now there's nothing wrong with this. That's actually correct and perfectly okay.
What's a pin on it?
Probably, if this was the AP exam, it would be written like this, 1 third x cubed plus 2x minus 4 natural log x plus c.
Oh,
now, here's the only thing that'll get, and you'll see in just a second, I think we get there. You'll see in just a second, yeah. The only thing that can be confusing about this is when it's not power rule. For example, sine and cosine.
Oh.
So, and here's where it gets confusing. We all know that what's the derivative of sine? What's the derivative of cosine?
Negative sine.
We all know that, right? But now you have to know the antiderivative because it's not the same. So, okay. Here we go. Okay, so next, rewrite. That's your friend. Rewriting is your friend. Before you integrate, rewrite.
too?
Whoa.
Oh, it would be.
Hey.
Okay. Sorry. But that's the only thing I missed, right? Yeah. Sorry, I just can't multiply. But that's it.
You can find the
easy.
Hold on.
Probably again, this term right here would probably be written as plus 1/2 x squared, but y'all all know that's the same thing, so you'd be fine. Rewrite this.
Okay.
As 2 x to the negative 1/2. All right, so now I'm going to take the antiderivative. So I'm going to add 1 to the negative 1/2, and that gives me 1/2. And then you have to divide by 1/2. Now, I'm going to write it that way. It's going to look a little crazy,
so
but 2x divided by 1/2 to the 1/2, and that will be what? 2 divided by 1/2?
4.
It's 4. Keep switch flip. So it ends up, plus C. So it ends up being 4.
So
x to the 1/2 plus, yes, so it ends up as 4 square root x plus c.
There's nothing to do but plus c.
No, not yet. We will, though. You don't have enough, at this point, you don't have enough information to do anything about the plus c. Okay. So the only weird thing on this one that we encountered was this.
No, it's
and the only thing that causes that is a power of zero. When you get that power of zero situation, you know you have a natural law.
Whoa.
Okay? That's the only thing that causes that. Okay, so here we go. So we learned that the derivative of sine x is cosine x, and the derivative of cosine x is negative sine x. So the antiderivative of cosine x is sine x.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Sure.
And the antiderivative of sine x is negative cosine x.
Ooh, that one doesn't make... Wait, why are you doing negative in the cross?
Because the derivative...
Because I thought if it was a sine x and you're going to cosine, it'd be a negative sine.
So if it was negative sine, it
would
be cosine, right?
Oh, yeah. Okay, never
mind. That's why. So it's... And that's why I say that it's a little bit tricky, only because you just have to remember which one's which. And it can be tricky. So I don't know the ins and outs of what they let you do, because they won't let me, I'm not allowed to administer the AP exam. So I don't know all the ins and outs of what you can and can't do. But things like that, I would write at the top of my test as soon as they gave it to me. I would be like, derivative of sine is cosine, derivative of cosine is negative sine, the antiderivative of sine is negative cosine. Because I forget, especially in a moment like that when the test is craziness. Okay, so antiderivative of 2 sine x. Well, the antiderivative of sine x is negative cosine x, and the 2 is just a coefficient. So it becomes negative 2 cosine x plus... The antiderivative of cosine is just sine x.
Plus C.
That's it.
I don't like it.
It sounds more complicated.
Okay, add and divide. So this is t to the third over 3. The antiderivative of sine is negative cosine, but it was negative sine.
So cosine.
So it's positive cosine.
T plus C. Hey, I can do this. I can do it until I don't do it with this one hand, and then I can't do it anymore.
So what is the 4x going to be now?
It's going to be 2x squared.
2x squared. Because it would be 4x squared divided by 2, but that makes it 2x squared.
Whoa. What do you do when you have a coefficient and it's just going
to
stay there?
Yeah, because remember, when you take a derivative, the coefficient gets to stay there. Because it's really product rule, but the second half cancels out. So the derivative gets to stay.
So it's just going to be plus...
So, okay, so the derivative, the antiderivative of cosine is sine.
Oh,
so it's just minus 3 sine x. Okay, before I integrate this next one, I'm going to rewrite. It's going to be x to the 1/2 plus sine x. So when I add, that's x to the 3/2, which you divide by. or multiply by the reciprocal, right? Divided by fraction.
So it's going to be 2/3 x to the 3 down.
Yep. What about sine x? Okay. Use the given information about the first and second derivatives to find the original function. Okay, so first of all, the antiderivative of the second derivative is the first derivative.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Plus c, yes?
Yeah,
sure.
And the antiderivative of the first derivative would be the function plus c. Yes, everybody good? I'm not going to write that for you, though. Okay, so that means the antiderivative of 2 that they gave me, I'm just plugging in numbers now. The antiderivative of 2 dx is now 2x plus c.
Whoa.
I just took the antiderivative. Remember, power rule says you add one exponent. Well,
yeah, but I thought that was saying what the answer was.
Oh, hold on. I'm not there yet.
Then why?
What are we doing? You're crazy. You're crazy.
So,
I don't know.
So I just found out that f of x equals 2x. Not f prime of 2. I found f of x equals. So I just found this.
F prime of x.
F prime of x equals 2x. That's what I just discovered.
Because f prime of
x
equals 2.
Okay, now, no, because I took the antiderivative. So, the second derivative equals 2. So, f double prime of x equals 2. So, I just plugged in 2. And then I calculated the antiderivative. So, I added 1 and divided by 1. Added 1 and divided by 1 plus c. So I took the antiderivative of this. Ignore this. We can't even use it yet. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Sort of. So just for just a second, ignore all that for just a second. And if I told you that f double prime of x equals 6x plus 1, and I wanted you to find the antiderivative of f double prime of x, that would be 6x squared divided by 2 plus x, yes? Which is 3x squared plus x. I just found the antiderivative of this. Yeah? Okay, so we're doing the exact same thing. It just so happens that it wasn't a polynomial, it was just one number. So they told me f double prime was 2, and then I found the antiderivative and got 2x plus c. So since it's the antiderivative of the second derivative, that makes the first derivative because we're backing up. Well, they told me that f prime of 2 equals 5, so I can plug f prime of 2 equals 5, so that means 2 times 2 plus c has to equal 5.
Hey, why?
So c equals 1, which means f prime of x is actually 2x plus 1. Everybody okay? Now, I can take the antiderivative of that and back all the way up to the function. So I'm going to take the antiderivative of 2x plus 1. What's that going to give me? 2x squared divided by 2, which would just be x squared
plus c.
That's what I just found was f of x. Well, they gave me the information up here that f of 2 equals 10. So I'm going to plug 2 in. So f of 2 equals 10. So 2 squared plus 2 plus c equals 10. So c equals 4. Because 4 plus 2 is 6. So I just discovered by using the antiderivative that f of x is actually x squared plus x plus 4. So we used our original second derivative. We used the antiderivative and found the first derivative. Then we used the antiderivative and found the first, the original function. Y'all sort of okay? A little bit? Okay, try number two. I'm going to give you a second, see if you can work it out.
Try number two.
I'll give you my best shot.
I just told you I couldn't do this. Or am I doing this wrong?
Derivative of negative 2x and negative 1 half plus 3. dx. So.
How much is increasing?
Okay, it is. How much is increasing when?
That year.
It's the instantaneous rate. At 3 years, this is growing at. So you have to say that. Okay, so what they gave us was the rate, how the height is changing each year. Part B says, find an equation for h of t, the height of the shrub, at any year of t.
Now we use
the antiderivative, because what we had was the first derivative, and we need to go back to the function and just get height. So we're going to use the antiderivative. Probably this would get you points right here if you did just that. The antiderivative of dh dt, that's going to tell me h of t plus c. That tells the test people that are reading the test that you know what you're supposed to do. Now if you mess up the math, you've at least gotten a point because you know what you're supposed to do. But you subtracted wrong or added wrong or whatever. Okay, so now I'm going to plug in the antiderivative of 1.5t plus 5dt. And I'm going to take the antiderivative. So 1.5t squared divided by 2 plus 5t plus 2. After you add, then you divide.
By the same power.
Yep. Okay, so 1.5 divided by 2 is 0.75. If I divide $1.50, it's 75 cents. So I'm just going to simplify that. Because that makes me feel better. All right, now remember, they gave us a point back here. They gave me the 0.012. That I can plug in so that I can find C.
So C will be 12.
So, 0.75, yes, plus 5. So my actual final H of T is 0.75 T squared. Plus 5t plus 12. Now it says, it also says, then determine how tall the shrubs are when they're sold. And it says they sell them at 6 years. So then we just plug in 6. Comma. I thought it was an exponent. Yeah. I just wrote that back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just
wanted to find myself, so I forget. Okay. You can still yeah. I think you have it. I found it. Okay, you got until next time. I'm good, how are you doing? You don't have to today. This is Friday. Okay. We'll go on Monday. Okay. Did y'all paint yesterday?
I was the one that was there, but I painted before.
I wasn't here yesterday. I had to go to Pilot.
I want you to work by yourself.
It's fine.
It's well, good. Thank you. I just want to know if you wanted to go back. No, not on a Friday. We'll do it on Monday. What are you doing? I was very I need, that's what I need to be.
Just to get myself.
That's what I have to do.